Good morning. Welcome to Polk Street United Methodist Church. I'm Leslie Broadbent, the senior pastor here at Polk Street. We want to welcome you to worship with us this morning, this beautiful, beautiful Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all of those who are here today, those who are joining with us online in our television broadcast as well. We want to welcome you warmly. If you are a first-time guest here at Polk Street, we also want to welcome you warmly. We recognize that we have first-time guests every single Sunday here in the life of our church. That's what it's about, being part of a growing downtown, vibrant community of faith. And so we know that it takes a lot of courage to try out a new church. You're not exactly sure where to park in the parking lot or what style of worship that we have here at Polk Street. And so we want to thank you so much for taking the courage to try us out. Our ushers will be passing around our attendance registration pads. If you would just simply register your attendance, we would appreciate that. If you are here for the very first time and you would like to leave us a little bit of contact information, we also would appreciate that as well. We will not put you on any permanent mailing list until you might be ready for that, but we would love to be able to connect with you more appropriately today. So make sure that you sign up on those attendance registration pads. Also, there in your bulletin, you'll find a number of opportunities of things going on in the life of our church. Next Sunday is a really, really special day in the life of Polk Street. It is the 52nd year that we have had our God and Country worship service. It'll be next Sunday. So next Sunday, we will have only one worship service. The starting time of that worship service will be at 10:45. So it's 10 minutes earlier. We will have a wonderful, wonderful day. It will have a full orchestra, a full choir as well, as we celebrate both our faith and our country. Also, following that God and Country service, we will be having a hamburger and hot dog feed over in the Great Hall in the Christian Life Center. There are going to be a number of reasons for that hamburger feed. One, we just want to fellowship with one another. Two, we will be welcoming our next associate pastor, Stephanie Gilkey. It'll be her first Sunday next Sunday. We're excited about that. We're also going to be accepting free will offerings or donations for our choir to be singing at Carnegie Hall this fall. And so if you want to help support that trip of our choir, bring a free will donation. But then also, and you may have seen it in today's paper, the very front page of today's Amarillo Globe News, there's an article about our very own Dr. George Biffle. George will be retiring next Sunday, so it'll be his retirement celebration. He has been in ministry all across Amarillo and here at Polk Street for a number of years. His music ministry has, there are very few people across the Amarillo area and really the Texas Panhandle, if they have been involved in music, very few have not been touched by the ministry of George Biffle. And so again, we're excited about his upcoming retirement. We're excited for him. We're excited he's going to be able to spend some more time with his lovely wife, Nancy, and their family. So next Sunday, don't forget about that. And then finally, there you'll find some information about our Four Amarillo Missions Week that's coming up. We join together with our other sister churches, downtown churches, and we are in mission together. So that'll be coming up on June the 27th through the 30th here in just a few short weeks. So we hope and pray that you will join with us in that. Well, I'm dragging just a little bit today. Not only was it Vacation Bible School this past week, but also I was at an annual conference. An annual conference is a wonderful time for United Methodist churches across our annual conferences to get together, but it's also very exhausting. Tomorrow, I'll be releasing a video highlighting what was decided on at annual conference this year. I'm excited about the kind of graciousness that we experienced this past week and the love that we have for one another. Though there are many churches and pastors think differently, they are all unified in their love for one another. And I think it was a complete and total model for what we as a denomination and how we as a denomination can handle the situation that's in front of us. And so tomorrow, I'll be releasing a video and sending that out. It'll give you more information about what was decided at annual conference. Well, if you are here in person, if you would, please stand. No doubt, some of you are here today because it's Father's Day and you wanted to come to church with your dads. Some of you are here today because we just simply love being together and love worshiping in this wonderful and beautiful downtown church in Amarillo, Texas. But the most important reason that we are here today is that Jesus Christ is alive. Amen? Amen. That's what our faith is about. Our faith is about Jesus the Christ. If you would, turn in your hymnals to number 144, This Is My Father's World.
Kevin Deckard, Associate Pastor here at Polk Street, and I invite you to join me in prayer. Lord, we've come to worship you today, and we pray for your Spirit to fill us and lead us into your truth and the blessing of the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, for the salvation of the world. Lord, help us to honor you in all we do. Help us to remember, Lord, it's not about us, but it's all about you. Thank you, God, for this day that you've made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name, amen. Join me in our affirmation of faith. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all things we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, friends. Y'all doing okay today? Yes. All right. I'm so glad to see you all today. You look great. So, you know what I've been thinking about lately? I have been thinking about love. Yes, I've been thinking about things that I love. And you know what I love? One thing that I love? I love ice cream. Yeah, yeah. Is anybody else with me? Yes, I have the right crowd today. Awesome. Ice cream is like the best. If I could eat it every day, I would, you know, if it was healthy. But it's not, so I don't. But, and you know what else I love? I love our puppy dog, Bo. Look at him. Is he not the cutest? And he's wearing a bow that would make Gary Moore jealous. Yeah, and maybe Antonio. He's another bow wearer. But his name is Bo, and he's wearing a bow, and he's just so cute. Oh, my goodness. And then you've heard of puppy dog eyes, right? Oh, my goodness. Tell me, are those not the cutest puppy dog eyes? Make your heart melt. Give him whatever he wants, right? Yeah. Oh, my goodness. So I love Bo. I also love my kids. I also love my parents. I also love my husband. And all those people, they love me right back. But you know who loves me even more than my own parents and even more than my husband and even more than my children? Can you tell me who loves me more than all those people? Awesome job, Anna Ruth. High five, girl. Nice. Yes, yes. Jesus loves us. God loves us more. Way more than those people love us. Can you believe that? It's hard for me, especially as a mom now, to imagine someone loving my children more than I do. Because I feel like, you know, I love my children a lot. And I know your parents love each of you so, so, so much. But God, He loves us all the time. And you know what? He loves me even whenever I mess up. He still loves me just the same. And today's scripture, I wanted to read part of that to you guys today. It comes from John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that everyone who believes in Him may not perish, but may have eternal life." And, you know, whenever you guys read that, I want y'all to change this up a little. This is the way I want you to think about it, okay? So, "For God so loved Maddie that He gave His only Son. For God so loved William that He gave His only Son." "For God so loved Anna Ruth that He gave His only Son." I think it's important for us to turn some scriptures into personal. Put your name there. Say, "For God so loved me that He gave His one and only Son to die on the cross for our sins." And when you stop and really think about it, it's one thing just to read a scripture, but if you stop and think and put your name in that spot, it gets really personal, and it just makes a difference in there, and it really hits you as to how much God loves you, because He did do that for you. He did it for Catherine, yeah, because He loves you so, so much. So I want you guys to think about that this week. I want you to read that scripture and put your name in there and really let it sink into how much God loves you so, so much, okay? All right, let us pray. Dear Lord, thank You so much for this day. Thank You for loving us. Thank You for dying on the cross for our sins. Thank You so much for loving us more than we can even imagine. Help us to show that love towards others. In Your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As we enter into a time of prayer, I invite you to take a look at the back of your bulletin to find a list of those we're praying for this week. Of course, this is not an all-inclusive list. I would venture to say that everyone in this sanctuary today has someone that needs to be lifted up to the throne of God's grace and love and healing power. You'll have an opportunity to name that name of that person that you want lifted up during our prayer time today. Also, everyone is invited to come and pray at this altar rail with us during our prayer. Let us begin with a time of silence as we go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for a time to bring the prayers of our hearts before you. We're grateful for the open door into your presence through the sacrifice of your Son. So we enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. We praise your name and acknowledge today that you are the giver of all good things. Your love never fails. We pray that our lives will be living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to you. We ask a special blessing on this day for all those in our lives who have been faithful fathers, for those who set examples of love and integrity and have shown us a better way in life. We also pray for the fathers who have failed us at times and have even caused us harm. We ask for the grace to forgive and also to heal wounded relationships with both the living and the dead. We give you thanks for Vacation Bible School this past week, for the volunteers and children who participated. We pray that the seeds of faith in your Son Jesus planted in the hearts of the little ones will grow and mature into full-grown faith. We pray for those who have been hospitalized this past week, Heather Elias and Jan Chandler. Bring your strength and your healing to each one that we have named and those we have not mentioned. We pray for Stephanie Gilkey as she makes a transition from First United Methodist Church, Clarendon, to Polk Street. Lord, we pray for other pastors as they make moves in our conference and ask, Lord, that you would help them as they make these moves and leave congregations behind and hopefully welcomed by open arms by their new congregations. We pray this morning for the message that Pastor Leslie has for us today, for your Spirit to empower him to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. We pray for this body of Christ to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Help us to press on toward the goal and hear your voice following you wherever you lead us. Help this congregation to continue to make a difference as we reach out to bless others in your name. Lord, we continue to lift up the churches in our area, and we thank you for the partnership and gospel of Jesus Christ that we share with these churches. Triumphant Truth Church, Life Fellowship Church, Rockwell Road Baptist Church, and Liberty Baptist Church. Now, Lord, we hear the names from this congregation who need your master physician's touch. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Now let us join together as one voice in saying the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite our ushers to make their way forward to receive our tithes and offerings. How many in this congregation pray? I want you to lift your hands if you pray at any time. All right, some are not lifting their hands, and we hope that you'll begin praying soon. My appeal is that I need prayer warriors, prayer intercessors for the school days this coming school year to come to San Jacinto Elementary School, to stand on the property, which means like maybe the sidewalk or right on the parking lot, and pray over that school. Each and every school day they're there. And I want to even begin 2 weeks before school begins, maybe August 1st. If you're willing to take a day to do that, I want you to contact me. I'll make a list. We'll probably have more on each day, so we'll have people that we can switch places with so you're not doing it every single week. But What better gift could we give to our partner school than to pray over them, the teachers, the children, their parents, and God's sovereign protection over that school? Let us pray. Lord, thank you for generous hearts you've raised up in this church. We ask a special blessing on these gifts. Lord, we want to take the message and good news of Jesus Christ, not just in our community, not just in our state, not just in the United States, but throughout the world, that Jesus Christ is both Savior and Lord. Help us to do this. Bless those who have given on this day. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Our hymn is Faith of Our Fathers, hymn number 710.
Please remain standing, if you would, for the reading of God's Word. Our scripture this morning comes out of the Gospel of John, John chapter 3, verses 16 through 17. Hear now these very familiar words to so many of us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him. This is the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you bow with me, please? Almighty God, pour out Your Spirit upon this, Your Word, and make it be for us the Word of life, that we might be people of life. And now, O God, may the words of my mouth and may the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and acceptable to You, and You alone, through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thousands of flights have been canceled over the last couple of weeks because there are not enough workers at the airlines. Gas prices are at an all-time high. The Fed's increased interest rates by 0.75 points, the highest rate increase in 28 years over the last 2 years, even though it's been more than 2 years since the pandemic began. The number of deaths reported is almost the exact same as they were 1 year away, 1 year ago. The drought in the Southwest United States is an historic drought, dealing with wildfires all over the southwestern parts of the United States, but also just as historic was the flood that hit Yellowstone National Park last week. It's been reported that 200 Ukrainian soldiers are being killed every day by the Russian army, and almost 2.5 million people in Ukraine have been displaced. The recent downturn in the stock market has officially now put us in a bear market. Crime, particularly violent crime, seems to be running out of control. I don't know that you've noticed this or not. Likely you have. News is not good. I'll tell you, I think I could probably have preached this sermon 6 months ago, or 6 years ago, or 60 years ago, because this is a broken world. It's a broken world. It always has been a broken world. We find it throughout Scripture. We find the brokenness of this world throughout Scripture. We find the brokenness of humanity throughout Scripture. We find in our own lives a world that is broken and full of despair, a world that is lost and dying. A decade ago, I was asked a question by a 10-year-old little boy who was in one of my congregations, and the question was asked through a questionnaire that I sent out. And the questionnaire asked, "What questions do you have about faith?" And this little 10-year-old boy, he signed his name, that's who I knew who it was from, he signed his name at the bottom of that questionnaire, and his question was, "How do I get to heaven?" It seems like a simple question, doesn't it? It seems like a very unsophisticated kind of question. I think really what he was asking is, who is going to rescue us from this disappointment and pain and despair? What's the answer to all of this? What's the answer to all, and by the way, all of those things that I listed earlier, that was simply what was in the headlines of the news yesterday morning. It's a dying world. It's a lost world. Today we're starting a very short little series, and I've entitled it Sermons from the Pews, and the title comes from questions that I have asked of my congregations over the years, and I've not yet done that here. Don't worry, you'll get a questionnaire here, I suspect, here just in the next few months, but I always want to know what questions people have about their faith, and that some of the answers and some of the questions that people have about their faith are as simple as a 10-year-old's. But then some of them are as complex as someone who had lived a long life, and they're wrestling with deep questions of faith and issues that they just don't seem to have any kinds of answers to. And so I'm going to be attempting to answer some of the questions that very likely, whether we are 10 years old or whether we are 90 years old, we have these types of questions in our faith. And so the question that we're examining today is, how do I get to heaven? Again, I think phrased another way, who in the world and how in the world are we ever going to be rescued from this dying and dark and lonely world that's full of despair and brokenness and pain? How are we ever going to be rescued from this? Now, I think this question, it's not just about what's going to happen to us in the afterlife. I think it's also about, how do we experience heaven here and now? How do we experience some sort of release and freedom from this world of brokenness? Now, there are lots of answers to that question in our culture. Some have turned to government and politics as a way of saving in this world. They believe that if we could ever get the right president in office, then that president would solve everything. That president would answer all of our questions. That president would be able to put everything right. Others believe that it's not just about the president, it's also about their political party. If we could ever get everybody to vote Democrat, then all of our problems would be solved. If we could ever get everybody to vote Republican, then all of our problems would be solved. Well, over 200 years of American history have taught us something else. And I would suggest even the history of humanity has probably taught us something else. The role of government is not to save us. And the role of politicians is not to save us. But no doubt, we all understand. We all understand that even politicians with all of their power, cannot rescue us from this world of despair and hopelessness and pain and death. Others have turned to education. If we could just ever be educated well enough, if we could just have more information, then that would solve everything. That would solve everything. If we just learned more about other people, if we learned more about other races, if we learned more about the plight of the poor, if we learned more about other things, if we just had more information, then that would solve all of our problems. If we just knew more, that would solve all of our problems. Experts tell us today, however, that we have more information at our fingertips than ever before. In fact, there are some scholars who say you take all of the information, all information of humanity, between the beginning of humanity and around 1950, you take all of that information over those tens of thousands, even millions of years, you take all of that information, and the information that we have at our fingertips right now is more than all of that information combined. We have more information at our fingertips than ever, ever before. And I suspect it wouldn't take more than about 5 minutes on Twitter to recognize that more information is not going to solve all of our problems. Others have said, if we can just all get along, then that'll solve everything. If we can all just be unified, if we would just all work on our relationships, then all of our problems would go away. It would all be fine then. A number of years ago, one of the men that I have such an honor to be his pastor, his name was Jim. I've mentioned Jim before. Jim was a great, great person of faith. He was incredibly optimistic and just a big bear of a man. He was so gregarious and so friendly. He had been a trainer for the Dale Carnegie Institute for over 50 years. And if you've ever met anyone that had some background in the Dale Carnegie Institute, you know what kind of a man Jim was. He was a great, great man of faith. I think likely the greatest layman that I've ever had in any church. Just an incredible, incredible man. Jim was an incredibly faithful man as well, fully a supporter of mine. No matter what, there were decisions that I made in that church that he adamantly disagreed with, but he always supported me in those decisions. He may have disagreed with that decision, but he fully supported me. And he would brag on me all over town. People that knew him, they all believed that he really did have the best pastor ever. Jim contracted, he got cancer, and he was dying of cancer. And so I went and saw Jim a number of times. And it was one of those very few times, in fact, I think it was probably the only time, that I ever saw Jim not with that optimistic, great big smile and grin on his face. The cancer had gotten into his bones, and he was in significant amount of pain. He was on heavy doses of morphine, and he knew that his end was near. And he was in a lot of pain. And he too was... watching the news like everyone else was, and he too knew the brokenness of the world, and so he began to recount all of the troubles in the world and how worried he was about this world. He was so worried about the world. He was so worried about the church that I was pastoring. He was so worried about his beloved wife that he was leaving behind. Jim had done everything in the house. He had paid all the bills for well over 50 years. He had taken care of all of the business. He was so concerned about Lois. And so after this litany of all of the difficulties in his life, and really even the despair in his life, he looked at me and he said, "Pastor, but here's the fact, we're all going to have problems. We're always going to have problems. There is nothing that will make our problems go away, but there is something that gives meaning to our problems, and that is Jesus Christ. We're going to have problems. We're all going to have problems, but we don't have to be in despair. We don't have to be hopeless. We don't have to be unhappy or dejected or despondent, because we have faith in Jesus Christ, and faith in Jesus Christ conquers all. Scripture is one that we likely all know. Whether you've never been to church before, you've likely heard this passage of Scripture. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. A lot of us quit right there, but I think the second passage is just as important. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him. Who can rescue us from this dying and sick world? It is Jesus Christ. You know, this belief, those who believe in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. This belief is more than just an assent or an agreement that these things are true about Jesus. It's more than just a cognitive activity. No doubt, it starts with an agreement that Jesus was who He said He was. He said He was the Christ. We must know that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. We must affirm that He was divine, that He died on the cross, that He did in fact rise from the dead on the third day. But to believe means more than that. It means putting our trust and our faith in Him. It's more than just coming to church, dear friends. It's more than just sitting at home and watching a religious service on television. It's so much more than that. It's more even than reciting the creeds, although those are vital and important. It's more than just coming. I mean, just coming to church is great. If we're really good Christians, we'll even come to church the majority of the times. If we're a super Christian, we may even change pews every great once in a while. I don't know. It's more than that. More than that, it is putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Christ is the only one, the only thing that can rescue us from this world of death and despair. It's only in putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ that we have salvation. It's not in politics, it's not in education, it's not in just simply loving one another. It is all about giving our heart and our life to Jesus Christ. That's what it's about. So I believe this so much. I believe in this gospel so much that I'm willing to give it all for Him. I'm willing to lay aside everything in the world. I'm willing to lay aside my career. I'm willing to lay aside my family. I'm willing to lay aside even my life for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what it means to be a follower of His. That's what it means to believe in Him. That's what it means to have faith and trust in Him. It means that we trust Him with everything. So when we believe in Him, we will have everlasting life. I think when John is talking about everlasting life, he's not just talking about heaven on the other side of death. I think he's even talking about heaven here on earth. You want to be rescued from this world of pain and despair and hopelessness? You have faith in Jesus Christ. And then life begins to have meaning. Suffering then begins to have meaning. Hopelessness then is turned to hope. Despair then is turned to joy, and it only comes in faith in Jesus Christ. No doubt, believers in Jesus Christ will spend eternity with Jesus Christ in heaven, but also I believe that we will experience heaven here on earth. You want peace? You want freedom from the despair of this world? You want a release from the brokenness of this world. Faith in Jesus Christ. It's the only thing that'll bring you peace and hope and true life. Would you bow with me? Oh God, we are good church men and church women. And we are good people. And we work to restore this world. And we work to be good. But none of those things saves us. Not one of them. Your word says that the only thing that can save us is Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, on this day, we look to you as our Savior and as our Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus, we give you our hearts and we give you our lives. We give you our sin. We give you our trust. Lord Jesus, come and remove the guilt of our sin from us. Come and give us power over sin in our lives, that not only might we be saved, but that you might be Lord of our lives. Come, Jesus, be our Savior and our Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you are here in person, if you would please, if you are able to stand, turn in your hymnals to number 337, if you would. Some of you might be here today and you've never really put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. It may be that you've been coming to church for years, possibly even decades. Just being in church doesn't make you a Christian any more than standing in line at a fast food place makes you a hamburger. It's not what makes you a Christian. What makes you a Christian is following Jesus Christ, trusting Him, putting your faith and trust in Him as your Savior and Lord. It may be that there are some here that are joining with us in our television broadcast and you wonder why you have joined in today. It may be that God is calling you to trust Him, to trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you've made a decision for the very first time today, maybe you've made a recommitment of your life today, I would encourage you to visit with me, call into the church office, visit with me after the worship service. You're even welcome to come forward and pray at the altar as well. Number 337, Only Trust Him.
Thank you.
And now go as those who are trusting the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, giving you hope, giving you meaning, giving you salvation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.